Ladies and gentlemen, very good morning. My name is Haresh Khoobchandani, and I work for a small software company called Microsoft. And I've been doing so for the last 13 years. Despite my white hair, I'm not that old. I've been working for a few years, give and take 19 years. And I just want to tell you a little bit about my background so you understand a little bit where I come from and who I am. So I left, I'm Singaporean, so you know, in Singapore you go through the army, and you got to do 2.5 years those days. Now the boys are lucky, they do 2 years. And I did 2.5 years, I came out, didn't know what to do with my life, and I decided to travel the world. So guess what? I started out my career as a flight steward at Singapore Airlines. So if you've seen me and you recognize me, chances are you've got coffee or tea from me before. And I'm very proud of how I started my career. And it's taught me a lot. You know, it's a very, very humble way to start working in the airline industry, in the service industry. And over the years, you know, I did a whole bunch of different things because I decided to take, I needed a real a job and I wanted to build a career, and that wasn't where I wanted to be. And one day I stumbled into Microsoft. I literally stumbled, right? I got a call from headhunter and saying, hey, you know, they've got this consumer business. 13 years ago, not much of a consumer business. PC games, if you remember. How many of you are PC game players? Anybody here? Yeah? You guys remember Age of Empires? Yeah? So I launched Age of Empires in Singapore, right? So that was my claim to not so much fame, but at least into the IT industry. So I joined Microsoft with zero IT background. And it was a massive struggle. I can't tell you how big a struggle it is. I'm actually meeting today some people in the audience who knew me when I first joined Microsoft 13 years ago. I'm reconnecting with them after 13 years today in a completely different capacity. So they saw me during the days where I was attempting to play games and demo games and do all that kind of stuff. I joined Microsoft, and I struggled to settle in. Consumer marketer, business management in a hardcore IT company, numbers, numbers, numbers. And I'm like, what am I doing here? So 6 months later, into my job, I called up my headhunter who placed me there. And I said, you know, can you get me out of here? And she said, sure. And she says, I'll call you back. 13 years later, I'm still waiting for that call. And yeah, she hasn't called, and I haven't seen her since, right? I'm assuming she's still in Singapore. I don't know. It doesn't really matter. But it's been a humble learning experience for me. I've been in school for the last 13 years in Microsoft, and I continue to learn every day. And in my role, I have the privilege of meeting a whole bunch of different people who teach me something new every day. And that's why when I present to folks like yourselves who are experienced, who are thought-provoking, who have your own set of perspectives, I get to learn. So I want to encourage in the course of my presentation for the audience to be disruptive like the world we live in and put up your hands and ask questions and not wait for the Q&A at the end to be formal about it. It will be disruptive to my flow. There will be times where I'll forget my thought process, but that's okay. We'll figure it out. We'll kind of like connect the dots and we'll build off that. But more importantly, I think the session is going to be, we're going to get more out of the session if we interact, because I'm going to get a chance to learn from you guys, and you're going to hopefully get something out of it from me as well. And in the course of my next 90 to 95 slides that I have waiting for you guys, I was just joking, I don't have 90 slides. in the course of the next 20, 30 slides that I have, I'll be sharing some perspectives. I don't believe for a moment anyone's got all the answers. No one's got all the answers. Things are changing at such a rate that you don't have all the answers. And in the last couple of years, my team and I have basically experimented. And I disagree with my colleague from ESPN yesterday when he said it's not a leap of faith. At some point, it is a leap of faith. And it is a leap of faith because people are hesitant to change or try new things because they don't know if it will fail or it will succeed. So at some point, you just got to go out there and do it. I was talking to Thomas, who's at the back then, and he reminded me of how marketing is also evolving with regards to the difference between how marketeers market leveraging the rational mind versus the emotional mind. Right? In the past, there's a lot of emotional connection, and people who do marketing and connect with consumers on an emotional level tend to be a lot more successful than those who do it on a rational level. And that's been the success of some companies that are out there today. So marketing's evolving in a way that's completely, completely, completely irrational at some point in time. And guess what? At the end of the day, can you quantify emotional connection? Can you go to your CEO and say, hey, you know what? I want to do this, and by the way, I need $2 million, and what you're going to get out of it? At some point, someone's going to buy some product from you, but just give me $2 million now. What's going to do it? So at some point, it's a leap of faith because you know all the stats are saying, go digital. And I'm a big fan of digital. I'm a big advocate of digital. And I think every organization must go digital. But to what extent really depends on time, place, circumstance, situation, objective, all of that, the business that you're in. If you're in a media and content business, guess what? It's 100% digital. Doesn't make sense for you to go offline. But if you're in a business where you have a product and you've got retail, then it's a question of coexistence between the new world and the old world, right? The new world and the old world. And I'll show you in my last slide a life example of how the old world still exists and how the old world still exists in an efficient and effective way in our generation today. So I'm really excited about what the opportunities are. I'm really excited to share my perspectives. And I'm not going to go and sell you advertising space today, like some people did yesterday. But I want to focus on, I want to focus on marketing and what it means to marketers like us. And some of you are decision makers, business decision makers, CEOs, and what it means to how we need to turn around and think about decisions around marketing and its evolution. And again, I don't have all the answers. I have a bunch of experiences that I can share perspectives on. And that's what I want to do. In the hope that when you leave this presentation today, I provoke insight. I hopefully provoke some form of inspiration, and I hopefully provoke some form of thought that you're going to say, hey, you know what? I need to think about this, and I need to think about this really, really seriously. I really need to think about this seriously. And I'm happy to have that dialogue as the presentation goes on. And if you go over time, we go over time. It's okay. Sorry, Adam, wherever you are. The evolution of marketing. We're moving from an age of marketing where it's one way in terms of communication to a point whereby it's about conversations. And that's going to be a significant difference. Now, let me just tell you one thing. When you think about communities, please make no mistake. A fan page is not a community. A community is when you own the data, you own the relationship with the customer, you have privacy and security built in. A fan page is not a community. And right now, the association between fan pages and community is a misnomer. We have to be very, very clear about that. And we want to drive dialogue and conversations. You've got to understand your data. You've got to have data, understand your consumer. You can't drive a dialogue or a conversation with the consumer if you don't own the data. How do you do that? In public social networking services today that are available online, you don't own the data. And there are reasonable differences in terms of privacy and security. So we need to be very careful with regards to how we're embracing social media. Social media is a must. It's here, it's relevant, but it's a feature, not a destination. And I will continue to turn around and harp on that point because it's an important distinction between how we are thinking about social media versus how we potentially should be thinking about social media. How many of you have heard this saying, what happens in Vegas stays in Vegas? Anybody? Anybody been to Vegas? Yeah? Recently, yeah? You might want to be careful because nowadays, whatever happens in Vegas stays on YouTube, Flickr, Twitter, blah, 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 blah. Right? The world's changing, right? And it's changing faster than we all recognize or know. There's a revolution taking place. And one of the things for me in my role and my job, my experience is, because I come from a different background, a zero IT background, a lot of the experiences in the last 13 years has been about understanding technology, not the bits and bytes. I know I look like a geek, but I'm not a geek. I don't get the technical bits and bytes very well. But what I've learned over time is really to understand, what is technology actually doing to the world we live in today? How is technology changing the way we interact? Panel discussions 5 years ago, you will never find a panelist looking at Twitter live as he's giving answers and then trying to react to the audience. That's 5 years ago. Today, you had a panel yesterday, I forgot his name, but you had a panelist yesterday on his phone looking at Twitter and seeing how the crowd was reacting to the different answers being given. That's the difference. between yesteryear and today, right? So technology has had a profound impact with regards to how people are behaving, accessing information, sharing information, how they express themselves, right? Whether it's your daughter who's had an argument with you and posts something on Facebook and all her friends go, oh, da 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 da, versus, oh, my mom and I are best friends now. Oh, what happened? So happy for you. You know, everyone's expressing themselves from something as simple as that to getting pissed off with a product or a service and so on and so forth. And it's scary when you think about it because some of it can be abused. And I've had instances whereby large integrated resorts that are getting set up in Singapore, and there are only two, where as they get set up, people were using Facebook as a platform to vent in ways that are unreasonable. Because at some point, you've got to cut people slack because when you're setting up a new business, there will be some kinks in the armor. And we've got to turn around and give people time to iron it out. But the way people are leveraging social media or technology as a result, it's enabling and empowering people to make a variety of different decisions, change their behaviors, and so on and so forth. Now, understanding what that technology is doing and what are the implications with regards to how you, as a result, as marketeers, connect with your consumers is extremely important. Because if we continue to market in the same way, we're completely being irrelevant. I personally think marketers of today that exist today are getting obsolete faster than they even realize. They're getting obsolete faster than they even realize. Let me make another provocative statement. If you don't agree, you want to have a discussion, put up your hand, let's have that. And like I said, I'm making some of these statements because I want to force discussion and be provocative with regards to thought process, not just here, but generally outside as well. And what role do organizations need to play? How do you hold organizations like Microsoft, Google, Yahoo, Facebook, so on and so forth, accountable to say, hey, look, help me with this transformation? Because it's not just about selling display ads. It's about what role do you play to help me end-to-end to drive that experience? Selling display ads is one thing, but if your display ads don't connect across different platforms, what's the point? There's another big shift that's happening one more right now when you think about social media. How many of you know about Xbox Live? Yeah? Gaming, right? We've redefined the landscape on gaming. I don't know if you realized that recently. Have you guys seen the Kinect? The Kinect now is selling 2.5 times faster than the iPad. You guys aware of that? 2.5 times, just announced publicly. By third party, not even us. Okay? 2.5 times faster. We're redefining the way people play games today. One of the things that we're starting to see, which is really, really fascinating when you think about it, is people, youngsters, moving off Facebook or moving off social networking service in general, not just Facebook. Facebook, unfortunately, is a correlation, right? Because it's the most prominent one right now. Moving off social networking services and redefining social media interaction on Xbox Live. So a bunch of 15, 16 years old now are spending more time online playing Xbox Live games globally around the world, wherever they are, whether in the same country or around the world, using their mics to talk, IM to chat, and then video to basically see each other, which they don't do on a web page, for example, like a Facebook page. We're starting to see that trend pick up and pick up very, very fast, which is a very interesting thing. Now, whether it evolves to something big and it spreads like wildfire, I don't know. But we're starting to see behaviors change as we redefine gaming and how gaming is going to turn around and involve more people. So there's a phenomenal revolution that's taking place today. Xbox Kinect is just one of many that are going to come out. But it's nice. It's nice to see how technology is changing the way people interact. So more and more, the pressure is on marketeers to turn around and figure out, how do I now reach out to consumers and allow them to experience my brand across multiple different platforms and devices? Whether it's through the iPad, whether it's through the Windows Phone 7, whether it's through the Xbox or your TV, or whether it's through your PC. Being able to turn around and connect the dots is absolutely critical. So there's a massive revolution, and I want to welcome you guys to the revolution. And it's important not just to understand the statistics around the revolution, it's also important to understand the underlying pinnings of what that's going to do to shift the way we market so that we stay relevant and connected with the consumer. That's going to be absolutely critical. The opportunity for all of us, oh, I'm sorry, I thought this was out. The opportunity for all of us is the fact that 78% of consumers right at the bottom here 78% of consumers here trust peer recommendations. This came out yesterday in the discussion as well. Only 14% trust advertisements. And this is a massive, massive point that everyone needs to turn around and recognize. The fact that at the end of the day, people trust other people more than they trust your advertising. At the end of the day, your brand is slowly being irrelevant. We are losing control, if not lost control, of our brand more than we recognize or give credit for. And that's another very important distinction. So in the future, no one will recognize your brand potentially. So how do you stay relevant? How do you drive a dialogue, a conversation? How do you now turn around and think about all the fan pages that you have? So how do you move from fan to fanatic? Whereas fan is on a public domain and fanatic is on a community that you own. Because these fanatics are the ones who are going to help you be your advocates, to be your evangelists. These fanatics are the ones you're going to understand, you're going to have a relationship with. And they're going to go help you spread the word. So how do you move from where we are today as fans, all the thumbs up you have, to fanatics, to a community that you own, where you respect consumers' online privacy, security, you have the data, where you can turn around and milk your marketing investment for the future, you can monetize it further, you can data mine, you can use all the sophistication that's out there with regards to IT and how you turn around and monetize that further. That's going to be very, very important to do. In the course of this discussion, the next couple of slides, I also want to turn around and share about how we went through that journey and the framework we built that allowed us to land the change that we want to drive internally within Microsoft. Is it fully landed? The answer is no. Is it a journey? The answer is yes. Is there a lot of things to work on culture and mindset and org structure and all that stuff? Absolutely yes. But we put together a framework that forces all the different marketeers within Microsoft to basically come together and say, here's how we need to think about marketing as we move forward. And then that framework also includes an IT portion that says, if this is what we need to do in marketing, technology is an enabler, it's not a solution. Technology is an enabler, which is why social media is just an enabler. Social media is a feature, not a destination. And that's a distinction that everyone needs to be very clear about. So that framework allows you to think about how you land it in your organization. There are a lot of people who talk about the future and great. Here's where we are, here's where we need to be. But no one talks about the middle, which is the how, the question mark. And that's what I want to share a little bit about, because at the end of the day, it's great to know what the future looks like, but if you're not going to help me with the transformation, you're not a partner. You're a vendor selling me advertising space, and that's not what we want. We want more partnerships. So I love this particular video. It talks about the consumer-advertiser disconnect that's existing today. It talks about how consumers now want a dialogue. They want a conversation. It talks about how consumers want authentic conversations. Authentic conversations. Not conversations, but authentic conversations. They want people to be real, which is why I said yesterday, be careful when you go into, you know, when you engage social media in public. You've got to have a game plan. You've got to have a strategy. Because you've got to be transparent, you've got to be authentic, you've got to be real. You've got to listen, genuinely listen, and don't listen and patronize the person and say, thanks for your feedback, we'll come back to you, and then 3 years later, you still haven't come back to that person. Because there's a game plan that you require to scale, to stay connected, be in a relationship with your consumer. And this video highlights the advertiser-consumer disconnect that's out there today, and it's a huge opportunity for all of us as a result to think about how we want to market differently.
Hey there. Long time no see. Looking good.
Yeah. Let's just keep this simple. I want a divorce.
What now?
I think you heard me just fine.
Come on. This is me. What's wrong?
We don't talk anymore.
I just put down a mill on a TV commercial just to talk to you.
Exactly. You do all the talking. I never get a chance.
You talk on our website, can't you?
Sure. If I want to say, order this product.
See?
It's not exactly a dialogue.
What about the print campaign, You can't tell me you missed a billboard in Times Square. That was like a 200-foot-tall declaration of love.
You're saying you love me, but you're not behaving like you love me. It's not genuine.
I don't know. The agency said I was genuinely being funny. Genuinely being charming. They said you would love everything I did.
Would you keep your voice down. You're not doing a radio commercial. Look, whether you're funny or not, it's just I've changed, and you haven't. I mean, we don't even hang out in the same places anymore. You're not even listening, are you?
Coupons. You want coupons, don't you? Look, come by the store. I got two words for you. Loyalty, reduction. Am I right? That was it, wasn't it? Let's just hug.
If you knew me, you'd know I don't care about that.
Know you? Sweetheart, I know everything about you. You're 28 to 34. Your online interests include music, movies, and laser hair removal. You have a modest but dependable disposable income. Am I the only one not getting the problem here?
I'm out of here.
Oh, come on. Don't be like that. Look, I'll tell you what. Come back here tomorrow. I'll give you the chance to win a Bahamas vacation. There's a small chance, minuscule, but technically still a chance. Why don't you be like the old days?
How many of you can relate to this video? Anybody? Don't be shy. Apart from Jazz. Don't be shy. Can anyone relate to this video? I'm not talking about your personal life here, okay? About your discussion. You know, it's amazing, right, how something so simple is so profound, because that disconnect is real, and it's growing. And this is what's driving the irrelevance or the obsolescence of marketing professionals today. This is what they don't teach you in school today, because in school, the curriculum still teaches you the same thing, right? And everyone thinks social media is the answer to everything, not recognizing some of the pitfalls of social media. And a lot of the learnings we've had as a team, my team and I, when we develop a framework and execution around going digital, is really around tripping and falling and making mistakes. And through those mistakes, we actually say, hey, okay, this is what we can do, and this is what we can't do, and this is how we operationalize it. This is the contract of agreement that we have with our customers out there. You're not going to be able to get it right the first time, which is why you just got to jump in with 2 feet in, with an open mind, and with resources at the back, recognizing that you're going to make mistakes, and you're going to turn around and correct them as you go along. So the technology paradox. I love this. I think a lot of people think about this. I don't think people want to talk about this. And I'll say this, right? It's very risky for me as a technology employee of a technology company to say this. But the technology paradox is this. Life is getting easier for consumers. Maybe, maybe not. But what's definitely technology doing is making it easy for consumers is to express themselves, to share information, access information, transparency. That's what it's driving. And it's making it more complex for businesses as a result. So on one hand, technology is doing a great work in terms of improving productivity, collaboration, and all that we talk about. But on the same token, it is making it a lot more difficult for businesses, for marketeers, with regards to how do they cope in this environment. So think about it. I met a delightful lady for lunch last week. She's the VP of one of the publishing companies here, online companies here. And she said, Haresh, I have this challenge. I said, what? She says, you know, we were talking about this whole technology, the world, and what's happening around. She uses an Android phone. She's got an iPad. She's got a PC. And she uses Google Docs sometimes. And she said, my life's a mess. She says, my life's a mess. She says, I can't cope. So technology is supposed to make it easier for her, but because she's using all these disparate applications that are supposedly free, she can't cope. So the problem with technology right now is there are lots of great stuff coming out, but what's happening is because it's becoming easy for consumers to access and share information, and they're doing it through multiple devices, no company out there except one is thinking about how they are connecting technology, truly making it genuinely connected across the different devices, across a single platform that's integrated. What is the implication of that on marketing? The implication is brand experience. Because now you can track the consumer journey across multiple devices as a result through an integrated platform. And there's only one organization that's thinking about that, not just now, delivering it today, but delivering it for the long term. And I'll show you an example of what we've done later on with Chevrolet, where this November, not an old case study, but right now, they're launching Chevrolet in the US, the new model of the car, and how they're leveraging multiple platforms to drive a brand experience that's leveraging technology so people can experience the brand, the car, online, digitally, both in terms of online, combining online stuff and the offline bits in retail. Phenomenal experience. And they came to us with the problem. That's part of the value that I think advertising agencies will have moving forward. Because when you think about social media, it's not the start and end of it all. Everyone's hung up on social media thinking it's the answer and the solution to everything. It's not. So advertising agencies in the future are going to evolve. They're going to be solution, what they call systems integrators of the, in the IT world. They call them SIs in the IT world. They're going to be the SIs of the future in the advertising world, where they're going to be able to turn around and understand what problems you have as a business. And then they're going to go aggregate a bunch of different technologies or solutions, put them together, and then say, hey, Mr. Customer, here's your solution. And so I think advertising agencies have a phenomenal value to play in the ecosystem today for clients and have an opportunity, just like marketing organizations, to reinvent themselves. So the marketer's dilemma, and I'm faced with this. I faced this 3 years ago. And you know what? At the end of the day, every organization, technology or not, will face this. The transformation of marketing is going to be a problem everyone's going to face. How do I move from what's proven and successful to what is new and much needed? Think about it. Singapore Press Holdings, right? One of the oldest. Anyone from SPH here? There you go. It's okay. I know Jerome. SPH, one of the our leading Singapore Press Holdings. You know who they are. They've got print. They've got and there's a big chunk of their business. They reported record profits recently. Record profits. So people are still advertising there. Why? Because it works. Well, it may or may not work. I don't know. But a lot of people think it works. Yes, Ian. I was waiting for you to put up your hands.
I think if you dig deeper into that, all the profits comes out of their property. Their print is making a loss. So easy to say top line facts, but look underneath. It's Paragon that's powering their profits.
So, you know, the point you just brought up is brilliant. And to change reality, you've got to alter your perspective. So thank you for reinforcing that. Okay, there is a shift, and they are struggling. All right, but at the end of the day, if you look at organization, there's still a large chunk of money that's being put towards print. There's still a large chunk of money that's put towards print at the end of the day. And I'll talk about the Windows 7 example and how what we did differently with Windows 7. But you know what? Fragmented audiences, multiple devices, clutter, media landscape that's changing, involving consumer needs and behavior. How do I measure success? All of these questions are what marketers are asking today. A lot of it came out yesterday. So if I'm thinking of marketing now, how should I be thinking about it? Should I be thinking about it from a social media pivot? Or do I think about it about like how Jazz yesterday nicely framed it, in my opinion, which is we need a strategy. We need a strategy. And the strategy is not social media. The strategy is, how do I connect with my consumers? How do I help them experience my brand? It's no longer okay to go push your brand on the consumer. That's a no-no anymore. So how do I drive that? So social media, again, becomes a feature, not a destination. So some of the trends, so consumers want dialogues. You've seen that. Consumer companies are now investing in social media monitoring tools. But, you know, the sad fact is a lot of people are investing in social media monitoring tools. The sad fact is they don't go through the rigor of trying to define or trying to understand these monitoring tools and what they do and what they not do. Many people are basically partnering with companies that do social media monitoring that's largely technology-based. The problem with technology-based social media monitoring, it doesn't capture the true sentiment that's necessarily expressed online. Technology can't cope with that just as yet. So at the end of the day, when you think about social media monitoring, you need to find organizations that can have a balance between human intervention and technology pickup as well and analysis. And that needs to be absolutely critical. And so far, I've only found one or two companies out there that actually do that. So consumers spend more time on social networks than they do on corporate sites, which is very, very true, right? So then again, that poses a lot of challenge to consumers with regards to, so how should I be thinking about marketing? Which is why it's important to have a strategy and not just say, are you in digital? And I've had this experience. I asked a marketer, are you in digital? Yeah. I've got a Facebook fan page. Just because you have a Facebook page doesn't mean you're in digital, right? In fact, it's a liability. You know, you could just ruin your brand if you're not careful, if you don't have a game plan or a bigger strategy. So I want to talk a little bit about the case study. We talked about Windows 7 and this framework I talked about. It's very simple. It's not rocket science. But it forces a good discussion as you put everything into one page. So it's from communications to conversations. How do we have that conversation? What is the strategy? How does old and new coexist? So the communication engine is really simple. It's basically saying, hey, first step, let's get some insights. All right? Now, a lot of people get insights, but a lot of people don't use them. So that after we get insights, we force engagement. What do we want to do? We drive acquisition, and then we say, what does the campaign look like? And advocacy. More often than not, advocacy becomes an afterthought. Many people say, oh, by the way, we got to do advocacy after everything is done. A classic example is PR. Many people turn around and think of PR after the campaign is gone. So the campaign is done. Hey, by the way, Mr. PR manager, can you do some PR for me on this particular topic or campaign? So now, in my job, one of the biggest benefits I have or biggest things I enjoy is blowing up organizations, being able to trial new orgs. So one of the things I've done in the last couple of years is to blow up my PR org and to blow up my marketing org, and I combine the two. So basically, I have my PR head now leading both my marketing and my PR. Because I personally, for me, PR is in the heart of marketing. PR is about communications. Marketing is evolving to being a communication engine. So if marketing is about communications, PR is about communications. The difference now is, in the past, communications was one way. Now it's two ways. So we made that one person lead the two efforts, and it's been stunningly successful for us. Massive risk. The fact I kept my job means it must have worked, right? So when you think about the framework, it's very simple. So you go from insight, you go to advocacy. I'm going to show everything out right now. Let me just spend some time. Happy to have a dialogue again about it. I'm not going to spend too much time on the details, though. So you think about insights, it's really about tracking, identifying. And when I think about insights, the thing that always, always sticks to my head, the word before insight, is dynamic. You know, I was in a conference presenting once, and before me was a guy who was selling reports, and the reports were the traditional Gartner-type equivalent reports. So I went on, and when I was speaking, I was contemplating on whether I should tell him. I think it's a bit outdated, although we still use those kind of reports. But I also think that dynamic insights are probably the single biggest value consumer marketing teams can basically leverage today. And that you can get through online, not necessarily only through social media, by the way. There are many, many ways to get it. And we'll talk about that, and I'll show you a live example, what we did with Windows 7. And then you've got engage, what you do to turn around and start the conversation. And sometimes starting the conversation can be about a cause as opposed to a feature. Has anyone heard of the campaign we did called Save Social Energy? No? So we launched a campaign called Save Social Energy 2 months ago. It was interesting, right? I had just started, and one or two people on the team were there in place, and they said, hey, we're going to launch this campaign. And I said, okay, great. So they launched this campaign called Save Social Energy. We launched it. 2 days later, it got picked up on the Singapore Twitter sphere. Great, great feedback. Microsoft says Save Social Energy. 5 days later, it got picked up globally, US. We got a ping from our corporate communications and saying, hey, are you guys running this campaign? Great job, blah, blah, blah. US bloggers loved it, blah, blah, blah. It was going. Then we realized, hey, hang on. We're onto something here, right? I would love to take credit and say brain, you know, great brain, scientific, da, da, da. We did all of that stuff. But then we realized people were resonating with that message because everybody wants to be part of something bigger. They wanted to be part of a bigger cause. They want to be part about saving. They want to be part of saving the earth, green, blah blah blah, and this whole theme about save social energy was something everyone could resonate with. Everyone agreed that spending time online was really sucking up a lot of time. So tell me, how can I save social energy with you? And I want to be part of that dialogue. So suddenly we went from 500 in the first 2 weeks to 11,000 fans on Facebook on save social energy in the last 8 weeks. So it just took off like that, and it's growing every day. And are we doing a lot of marketing around it? No, we're not. Very basic stuff. But people are having a conversation and dialogue with us around safe social energy, which is absolutely fascinating. The challenge now is, great, all these fans we have, so just like what I said earlier on, how do we go from fans to fanatics, where the fanatics become your community? That's what we need to work on now. So I don't have the answer, so don't ask me that question later. But we can have a dialogue. And then you go back to acquisition, which I think you guys know, campaign and advocacy. Now, the thing I want to stress is this. There's a whole bunch of trackers and KPIs on every single thing. Now, we put a whole bunch of different things here so that you guys don't think this is a framework which is all fluffy, waffy kind of thing. It's really grounded so that every marketer should feel comfortable that we're tracking, we're doing this with a reason and not for fun. And then you've got the key engines behind that. Now, the whole back-end piece here, this is where the IT discussion comes in. What aspects of the back-end do you own internally where IT says we will invest to support or we can leverage existing platforms? And what aspects of it do you not own that you outsource, whether it's to an agency, through an agency, Facebook, whatever not. But that whole discussion needs to happen today. So with the advent of cloud computing now, what's happening is a lot of the commodity IT, like email and stuff, is going to be put on the cloud. So guess what? As a result, your IT professional who's managing this infrastructure, time frees up. So now, these guys, the trend we see is these guys now are partnering with the business a lot more to say, what help do you need, Mr. Marketing? What can I do as IT to support you in your marketing efforts and needs? So we see a lot of this happening, but we also see a need for marketing to go drive that. So IT is an enabler, it's a supporter, all right? But it's not the solution to everything. And that's very, very important for everyone to understand. The other thing to take note here is this, customer support. Elevating customer support to a marketing engine. So if you're a product company, if you've got products like we do, what role does customer support play in this whole evolution of social media, in this whole evolution of conversation that you want to drive? We're learning still, but now we realize customer support can play a huge value add in the whole marketing process. How do you bring them into the conversation? Again, more often than not, they're not part of the conversation as well. We want to bring them into the conversation because at some level as a technology company, you do need people who understand the product, who have product knowledge, who understand the technical bits and bytes to answer some questions that do exist from that perspective. So this is what we did when we applied the engine to Windows 7. So Windows 7, we launched it. We started with insights. One of the things we started to do was we listened. The single biggest thing we did, and I said this yesterday, and I'm going to repeat myself now, with Windows 7 was we listened. We listened, we took, we understood, we processed, we put it into engineering, we built the product. So when you think about where we were with Windows Vista, which was obviously a challenge for us, I like the smile, which means he agrees with me, and many of you do, because I see more smiles coming out. It's okay. I'm not shy to admit that. If my boss, CEO Steve Ballmer, can come out in public and apologize to global audiences, there's no reason for us to be shy about it. We made mistakes, right, in the past, and that's the nature of growing up, that's the nature of learning. The question is, when you make the mistake, what do you do to come back? What do you do to turn around and earn trust back from consumers? Windows 7 is it. We launched the single largest public beta program, software beta program in the entire world. No other company has done that. We launched it live, and we gathered feedback, and we gathered feedback, and we gathered feedback, and through that feedback and that learning, we built Windows 7. In 1 year, we've sold 240 million copies of Windows 7. In Asia Pacific, that's 2.5 times more than Vista in the same time frame. That's massive. It's massive, and it's continuing to grow. And now organizations are accelerating deployment and so on and so forth. And someone yesterday tweeted and said, hey, you know, Apple outsells the PC. I appreciate the perspective, but the hard facts don't support it. Okay, the PCs are still outselling the Apples at the end of the day, and that's a hard fact, but great perspective nevertheless. So at the end of the day, we knew we had a winner in our hands, and we listened, right? And that was the thing. So culturally, there's a big, big shift. And when you think about that and how did that go on to the other products, when we launched IE8, wasn't that hot, right? A lot of people complained it was slow, da-da-da. Then we came out with IE9, and IE9's taken off now, doing really, really well for us. And then you got Windows 6.5, our previous version of the phone, and now you got Windows Phone 7, doing really well. So we've graduated with regards to making sure that we incorporate the listening mechanisms into how we drive product development. We're taking that learning and that richness and applying it back to marketing as well. So we ran a program where we did a lot of social media monitoring. We monitored a bunch of different conversations going on across the web. And this company that we used were phenomenal in terms of monitoring for us so that we can get, so that when they turn around and give us the insights were not only driven by technology in terms of crawling the web and blah, 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 but it was also being, sanitized by human interaction, all right? So they've got a model that scales, it's phenomenal. And we realized through these insights, 20% were positive of Win 7, 64% neutral, 16% negative, all right? Which was interesting. But we did this not just on Windows 7 and what people are saying about the beta, but we also were monitoring our competitors and what people are saying about the competitors as well. Now, the difference is this. We knew we had a winner with Windows 7, right? With all the beta comments going on, we knew we had a great thing. But the difference is, we knew we were, let's take 10 as a great number. We knew we were going to sell 10 copies, for example, Windows 7, even if it didn't do anything. So now the role of marketing and the challenge for my team was, what role does marketing play to ensure that instead of 10, we sell 20 copies? That was the key difference, and that's the value we brought to the table, and that's what we actually did. And I'll show that to you, right? And then we drove an engagement, and once we understood these guys here, the neutral guys, and the thing we understood about the neutral guys was what their concerns were, which is what was stopping them from saying, yes, I'm going to buy Win 7 at launch. What was stopping them? And we realized their concerns and the corporate messaging that came down did not gel. Which means corporate messaging was relevant, and we still have to do that. But when you think about the 64%, their perception or concerns and stuff was different from what the global messaging. So what we had to do was engage in a dialogue with these guys directly or through social media or through influencer programs so that they start to turn around and have a different perspective of the product, of their concerns, and we start to address them. And that's exactly what we did, and I'll show you how. As of now, this framework, regional.
Okay. So Singapore or APAC?
It's Singapore going towards APAC.
Haresh, what's the company you use for the insights mining?
What's the company you use for the insights mining? I'll repeat the question, Adam. I don't want you to sweat, you know, this lovely suit of yours. I'm hesitant to answer right now because I'm not a salesman for the company, but I'm happy to give offline answers on that one. All right? I'm not a spokesperson for a company, so I just want to be their salesman. I know I'm endorsing them indirectly. The framework right now is going APAC. In my current role, I want to basically operationalize it across the region. Okay? At some point, hopefully, it goes global, but we'll see. That's a different discussion altogether. So when you think about engagement, we then started to turn around and engage with these people. The combination of the engagement was, how do we start a dialogue? And guess what? The dialogue was not just about social media or online or digital. The dialogue was also understanding who the influencers are. Because the one insight we got was, you may have 4,000 conversations, but you know what? The people starting these conversations might be only about 10 or 15 or 20 people. These are the influentials. So you then build a program around them. And you know what? If you're transparent and you're genuine and you say, hey, I really want to have a conversation, they would really want to do it. And we did that. And they loved it. They couldn't believe, this Microsoft wants to have a conversation with me? With me? So yeah. We brought them in. We had a conversation. Next thing you know, they were posting stuff online. Things were shifting. Then we said, hey, do you want to invite your community? So these guys had their own community to our office for another conversation. They said, sure. Next thing you know, 150 people came in. And then we had another session for them. And next thing you know, the blogosphere was changing. Slowly we were addressing shifts. But it was not all about Facebook conversations. It was about understanding who they are, what they were saying, and addressing their concerns. And separating broad, sporadic posts with who are the influentials. And then we ran campaigns. We made sure all these connected. So our acquisition was largely online, how we drove acquisition. The campaigns was a combination of online and offline, retail and so on. And then finally, what were the advocacy programs? This, in my opinion, in the spirit of being self-critical, was probably a weak portion for us because it was new in terms of proactively thinking about advocacy. But we're getting better at that right now. So I feel good about the progress we're making. And then through this process, these are some of the insights we got. So what's the insights through the listening program? So this is buzz, and this is sentiment. Buzz basically refers to how many people are talking about you, a lot, a little, and sentiment is basically, is it positive or negative? So it's a combination of the two. And basically through this analysis, we realized this is where Vista was, right? Sentiment was negative, but buzz was very, very high. So a lot of people are talking about it, unfortunately, all negative stuff, right? Which didn't come as a surprise to us. And then you've got Windows XP, right? Where sentiment was positive and buzz was really, really high. So people liked XP, People were used to the legacy, and they're like, hey, that's fine. And then you got seven, where sentiment is very, very positive, but buzz is reasonably low. Not enough people talking about it. We say, okay, look, we have an issue here. So we know we'll sell the 10 copies, but that's not good enough for us. We want to make it the fastest selling operating system in the world. We want to make it history of Microsoft in Singapore. How do we do that? And then you had, obviously, our competitor. We've grayed out, so you don't know who they are. But we also met, managed it. So we saw, for our competitors, the sentiment is very positive. There are not a lot of people talking about it in that regard, relatively speaking. And through this insight, through this analysis that we did, we also realized where the chatter was happening. And the interesting thing is, our media company did not tell us go buy media on Hardware Zone, for example, in Singapore. They didn't tell us that. They didn't know. They were going through traditional means. So again, evolution that needs to take place. So through this, we realized where the conversation was happening. Through this, we realized what we needed to do differently. So it's not just about advertising and Hardware Zone, but we realized all the chatter was going on there. And we were not present at all, at all. So something was significantly wrong. And obviously, we corrected that through the methods I just shared with you earlier on. So this is a summary of the overall campaign. The thing about this campaign was it was modular in nature, if that makes sense. And when I say modular, because we were listening on a dynamic basis, on a weekly basis, we were able to turn around and take the feedback dynamically and tweak our campaigns accordingly. And as we led up to the campaign, we knew we were on track. So we had a great feeling. We were able to turn around and make some great bold predictions and so on and so forth. In fact, part of the radio campaign here that you see was launched 48 hours because we realized we did such a great job with Gen Ys, engaging Gen Ys, changing their perceptions, but we didn't do a great job with the Gen Xs who were actually giving Gen Ys money to go buy the software. So we said, hey, let's go launch radio. And we launched radio just to drive awareness, just to drive interest, just to make sure that the Gen Xs also understand what Windows 7 was all about. Management information session. Sorry, guys. Apparently, I have to attend this, but anyway. Real results. So essentially, we moved Windows from here, Windows 7, and we were right here. It was massive. It was absolutely massive. And we made it the fastest selling operating system in the history of Microsoft in Singapore. It was absolutely phenomenal. And it was intensive. It was intensive because when you turn around, organize the programs, you're trying to sync in a highly matrix organization. You can imagine the complications and the complexity. And let me tell you a real story, right? In one of the virtual team meetings, we actually had someone within Microsoft come in and tell us your plans won't work. The V team, a couple of weeks before launch, someone comes in and completely disruptive and said your plans won't work. How's that for culture? Right, for change. We stuck to our guns. As I call it, and some people may not agree, leap of faith. We stuck to our guns because you know what? That was the right thing to do. At some point, you got to trust your gut and your instinct and go because all the data can show you everything. But you know, everyone's got different experiences, and the person who said this has got a lot of experience as well. And that person's recommendation to us was to go print. You got to spend more money on print. And we probably spent, I think, only 2 pages of print ads. That's it. We had to be present in print. We only had 1 or 2 pages of print ads. That's it. The rest of it was all online and a little bit on radio. That's it. And we launched Windows 7 with 1/3 of the budget we spent on Vista. So that gives you a sense of the impact that we drove as a result. Any questions? Yes, ma'am.
Only.
How do you measure BOSS?
How do you measure BOSS? That's one.
Okay.
And the second one is if this BOSS measurement is only including your consumer experience or media as well, like you know, journalists talking about your product.
So for me, journalist is also a consumer. So it's whatever is being said. So buzz is about whatever is being said online. We don't segregate if he's a journalist or not. As long as it's being said online, it's a voice. That's how it contributes to buzz, regardless of who they are. So we don't segregate the two. How do we measure it? So you saw just now, there's a whole tracking methodology that the company provides that measures the buzz and sentiment indexes. I won't get into the technical details of it. But the way I look at it is this. Two portions, and I know there was an ROI question yesterday. One, don't get hung up on ROI for social media. Don't. We got to be very, very careful. That is an inhibitor in terms of the change you want to drive. You got to get focused on the overall campaign ROI that you want to drive and what you want to move. If you want to move a needle, you want to move the dial, you got to move the dial on an all-up basis, not an individual basis. You have indicators to track progress. But if you want to do specific ROI, then we'll get caught up in the weed and we'll never be able to turn around and make the change that we want to make right now today. So when you think about, I got 10 minutes, okay. So when you think about buzz today, at least the conversation that I was able to have with my bosses was, hey, we did a great launch, buzz was solid. Oh, really? Buzz was solid? Oh, great, okay. What was buzz? How do you measure it? I was able to say, here's where we were, buzz was -2, +2, whatever it is, da-da-da, and here's where we are today. The moment I took out that graph that showed where we were, where we are, and I said, Mr. CEO, do you want the gory details? He says, well, this is good. I don't need the details. Because at that level, they just want to make sure you know how you're making that progress and you're tracking. And the moment you can demonstrate that, and you've got to have the details, and we did have the details at the end of the day, but nobody wants to get caught up in the technicalities of the whole thing. That's the reality. And we did that, and that worked. But I was able to turn around, visually now demonstrate we've made that progress. And that was phenomenal, which in the past I couldn't do. In the past was, hey, we did a great campaign. It was really good. You know, people loved it. Loved it. You know, how do you know people loved it? That's your perspective. I heard, you know, I read, I saw Facebook. I had like 11,000 thumbs up. So people loved it, you know. But now I could say people loved it. And here's why. Here's where we were and here's where we are. Sentiment, buzz, relative comparisons with competitors and stuff like that. I had a science to something that was an art in the past, which is fabulous. Okay. Yes, ma'am. Sure.
Who are the team members, which department were involved?
Okay. Do I have to repeat the question?
Yes, please.
Can I share about the team members involved in the project, who were they, and which departments they were from, right? So Microsoft is a highly matrix organization, and V-teaming is the big theme, all right? Big theme. And so there were multiple parties. So we had the central marketing group, we had PR, we had segment representation, so people who basically engage with customers, we got them to get engaged as well. Customer support was part of it as well. What do you tell customers as a result? Who else was there? I think that's the gist of it. And then you obviously had our OEM partners, the people who work with the PC manufacturers, you know, they were part of the team. So there's a difference between the core team that sticks to their guns and drives the change and rams through an extended team. So the core team is always very small, 4 or 5 people. And then the extended team is obviously a larger team. I'm not a big fan of big V teams. I'm a big fan of small V teams that make decisions and just push us forward. Okay. Consumerism and convergence, a different tomorrow. You know what? I don't think it's a different tomorrow. I think it's today as well. And there are three things I'm going to speed through a little bit so that hopefully there's a bit of dialogue because I've been talking a lot right now. Connections, insights, and expressions. Let me cover this very quickly. One of the things we didn't cover, I've not mentioned about, is cloud. What is the role of the technology progress we're making around cloud on consumer marketing? What is the role? What is the impact? What's the implications? What is the ramifications? One of the things we need to be careful, we need to think about is, how do we leverage the cloud? Why is Microsoft so big on the cloud? It's not just about the commercial space, it's about the consumer space. Microsoft has been in the cloud for a long time. We've got 369 million Hotmail IDs globally today. It's a cloud service. We have 25 million Xbox users today, paying users today globally. That's a cloud service. We transact 9.9 billion instant messenger messages a day. That's a cloud service. So we've been on the cloud, giving cloud service to consumers for a long time. But now the cloud is seamlessly coming into our lives more than we even realize. Let me just share with you. So when you think about multiple devices, right, and you're trying to access them through multiple devices, whether you're doing it through your Xbox, which is one experience, your PC, another experience, your phone, another experience, And then you've got a whole bunch of different services. Right? This same guy has got different experiences, and the experiences are being driven and are being enabled by technology, if you think about it. So when you think about your brand and how your brand transcends to the consumer across these devices, no company today can do that in a seamless fashion. So when you think about the TV now, that's a big access point. And Kinect, Kinect is going to define that, because now Kinect brings the entire family into the household living room where they're going to be accessing that screen. How do you connect through that to hit a much larger audience? And how does that experience then transcend onto the phone and onto the PC? And the cloud becomes a key pivot point as a result. But that's just one. So when you think about consumer experience, it's not just about consumer products. You know, many of you will use Office products, for example, PowerPoint, Excel, Word, when you think about that. We now offer it free online. I don't know if you're aware of it. So PowerPoint, cloud, and all that stuff is all offered online. We also offer it here on the phone. So if you were to turn around, if you were to turn around and look at this phone, I have to do a plug for my phone. If you turn around and do this phone, oh, it was on Twitter just now. I can read what you guys are saying. Just kidding. So when you read, when you go to this phone, you see Office here. You see OneNote. You see all the documents, and you see SharePoint. How many of you use SharePoint? Right? SharePoint is a collaboration platform. It's built in here. You can access now your SharePoint documents from your phone. No one else can do it. So the ability for you to turn around and play games here with Xbox and to use this as a productivity tool to connect back to your office, to access your creative documents, to access your PowerPoint, your Excel, to then do stuff here, save it onto the web on a product called SkyDrive, which we provide free, 25 gigabytes of storage. Go back to your office, access your PC, pull it down to your PC. All of that now is being enabled by cloud, through the phone, through the cloud. To basically set up your Windows phone, it takes you about 10, 15 minutes to connect your entire world. So social media integration has been key. So you key in your Hotmail Live ID, your Hotmail ID, email address, into here. It goes up, goes to Flickr, YouTube, Facebook, blah, 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 pulls everything down for you. So your whole social space is up here, your contacts and everything, syncs with your Outlook, your business stuff is here, and you're done, you're fully connected in one place. Then you have the ability to turn around and decide what you want to upload when to where. You're empowered, you're the user. The good news is that's for consumers. For the IT guys, the geeks, the technical guys, the bits and bytes, they love it. You know why? It extends the existing investments that they have on the platform. So a lot of people are using Windows at the back end. This is just an extension. They don't have to reinvest money all over again. So the ability for IT to enable marketing becomes much higher as a result, much easier as a result. So when you think about connections, it's about connections and experiences. It's about consumer experience and technology enabling that. It's about how marketers understand the shift technology is driving so that they can drive a much better brand experience for the consumer. And then it's about you. The point I want to make on this slide, marketing, analysis, ROI, all of that can and is being done with digital. Digital allows you to do a lot of this. In the future, the way you need to think about it is products and services will find you and not you find products and services. A lot of the information that's going on to all the social networking services are information that they're data mining to better serve their customers. That's what they're doing. So all your fan pages feeding information and they're basically turning around and data mining that. Which is why when you think about building a community, you got to move from fans to fanatics so that these fanatics are part of your community. Your community that you own the data, you can provide privacy, security, and you can data mine, and then you can optimize your marketing investments for many years to come. Because at the end of the day, behavioral targeting is going to be one of the single biggest benefits digital is going to offer. And something that we're doing on a regular basis through our portals as well with SynMSN, with our advertisers. So it's not just about display ads, it's about smart display ads that connect to other properties as well. And last one's really around expression. Microsoft and, you know, I'm sure a lot of other companies as well, Microsoft itself spends $9.9 billion a year on R&D. If you take our two biggest competitors next to us, second and third, you combine the R&D spend, it still becomes smaller than $9.9 billion. And it's a significant amount of money, and it's something that we've been doing for years because of our commitment to long-term planning. That's one thing about the organization I love. So there's a long-term view. There's a short-term view because public listed, you've got to make your numbers, blah, blah, blah. You guys know how it works. But there's a long-term view that says, where is technology going, what it's doing? Not just in the commercial space, but we do a lot of research in medical as well. Many of you don't know, and I feel really proud when I hear these stories. We do a lot of things on the medical front. I'll tell you one of the things we do, a quick story. One of the things we do, we've worked with Harvard, where we've been able to turn around and help them develop through the power and magic of software, all right, to basically do analysis on the brain in a much faster, efficient way. Brain analysis apparently takes months to do, right? So you can take pictures and all that, but to analyze all the data, it takes months to do. And we've been able to turn around and fast forward that through partnership with Harvard and the software we've developed. We've also basically empowered independent software vendors to build on the Windows platforms, software that allows people who are paralyzed to basically communicate through their eyes. So software that basically you can move the cursor through your eyes and you can blink on a letter and you can type. And I've seen that. And if you haven't seen that, go to the Society for Physically Disabled, SPD, which is in Tiong Bahru, I think. They've got a center there which we've contributed a lot of money to. We've raised through public funds and our funds and with IDEA and all that stuff to build that center there. You'll see a showcase of those kind of platforms. So when you think about expression, you think about these kind of things, you think about brand experiences, you think about natural user interface touch, the beginning of it, and you'll see an example right after this. So expressions, every screen is going to be a living screen. All these things around you, they're going to be living in the future. All your little digital screens that you see, or your bus stops. If you go to bus stops, you see those little screens there. Those are going to be digital screens in the future. And this is not far away. It's all here. It's all here. It's just not commercially available today. It's all prototypes that are real. And I want to show you the launch of Chevrolet, the connected marketing experience, how we've helped Chevrolet do a different kind of marketing campaign that connects different devices so that people can experience the car, the brand, across the Xbox Live, across the phone, across the PC, and the web.
Screen campaign concept really takes this concept of natural user interface, of gestures, sight, voice, and touch, and really showing you how you can develop a brand experience across the screens that are important to consumers. Deep Zoom technology combined with Microsoft Pivot makes for a very natural and engaging way to be able to explore the vehicle. One of the things that's really important to us on Xbox is this concept of value exchange. We want to make sure that we're rewarding consumers for their time and attention. Auto's website will have a car configurator where you can go ahead and explore the vehicle, but we wanted to take this to a whole new level. The Chevrolet Bolt will be launching in select U.S. markets starting in November, and it's a completely new and innovative approach to a vehicle.
So this is done by Microsoft Advertising. And we do a lot of work in Australia around that, some cutting-edge stuff. We've done a lot of work here in Singapore. We've done some work for Gucci. We've done work for Sony. And Ultrasyn MSN, very interactive, cutting-edge stuff. I have all the examples, but I didn't want to show them today because the intention is here to say, hey, look, it's about digital. It's a big part of it. But digital needs to coexist. It's not all about digital. It's also about how you make the transformation. So the future is created by people who believe it, but I also believe the future is here. It's just not widely distributed yet. And it's not widely distributed yet for a variety of different reasons, because why fix something that's broken? If it's not broken, I'm not going to fix it. I'm going to continue doing the way I do. Change is obviously not something people are very comfortable with, but that's the only thing that's consistent right now in the world we live in, right? So I want to show you this quick video. This is a Microsoft video, hardcore. This is what's available in public. But it gives you a sense of the future of technology, what's happening, and why we're optimistic about the future and how we're investing for the long term as well, and what we're doing for consumers with regards to how we're connecting the web and Windows together. Okay, it's okay. I won't cover that. If you want to see, you go to YouTube, just type Future of Technology, you see that. It's a phenomenal video that's created out of the US folks. But I want to end with two more slides, Adam. Just this and one more, okay? The power of tradition. So we talked about digital, and everyone's saying, go digital, blah, blah, blah. You have to go digital. There's no two ways about that. You're going to be a dinosaur, you're going to be obsolete. But the power of tradition is very, very important. We must never, never forget that. Old and new must coexist. They must coexist. To what extent they coexist really depends on your objective, your industry, the kind of marketing you want to do, and so your circumstance, and so on and so forth. And this is a great story that I took out of a lady by the name of Frederick Covington. She wrote a book called The Dictionary of Change. And one, she identifies one trend here that's called the Dabbawalas. How many of you know what the Dabbawala is? Right? And these guys are a legend in India. They basically collect food from houses, right, of workers, and they put them in little tiffin boxes, and then they orchestrate themselves, and they go and ship it. They hand deliver it to each individual people. And let me read this. It's pretty phenomenal. The Dabbawalas have built up an extraordinary reputation for efficiency and organizational excellence. 170,000 meals are delivered each day with a 99.99% success rate. Some of your servers don't stay up 99.99% as well, as a matter of context. Word of their legendary logistical speed and accuracy is now spreading through the world of management consulting, where the search for methods promoting strong teamwork, strict time management, as well as human and social ingenuity without the use of technology is vital. I work for Microsoft, a company I have a lot of admiration for and love for. And over the years, you know, they've done, you know, stuff that we've learned from. We continue to learn, we continue to grow. But new and old must coexist. Make no mistake. We can't turn around and go the other way completely. This is literally my last slide. Marketing is such an exciting place to be in right now. But it's also such an exciting time where the change is huge. When you think about the financial crisis, one of the first areas where, you know, people managing P&Ls, first areas they cut was marketing dollars. Anyone experience that? Yeah? I did, right? And this is the reality, right? So the opportunity for marketeers to reinvent themselves, to drive self-renewal, is phenomenal. It's phenomenal. At some point, it's about facts, the rational mind, as Thomas reminds me, and at some point, it's about emotion, the emotional mind. It's about the leap of faith. And at some point, it's about finding the right partner to basically say, hey, help me through this transition. So the role we play as an industry player is not just about say, hey, advertise with us. Yeah, we want you to advertise with us because we can help you drive this transformation you need. We can help you connect brand experiences across multiple platforms. We can help you connect with consumers in ways whereby you could never imagine. And I encourage everyone to imagine what the future can be enabled by technology, because the future is here. It's just not very widely distributed yet. I hope you guys enjoyed the discussion and got some great insights, and I hope I managed to provoke some thoughts that's hopefully going to drive some great positive change, and I look forward to hearing from all of you about it. Thank you very much.